my crew is gone, so we're ad-libbing here a little bit with my new crew, and I ran out of time to tell them everything to do. So, hey, it's good to have you here. We're live from the SEC studios in White Bear Lake, and I think we've got a great discussion tonight. We're going to be talking about the Rushline corridor that's coming through Maplewood, St. Paul, how that's going to affect the community. And before we get into that, I want to remind you of what we will discuss later on in the show if we have time to get to it. In the press has been a lot about the Sandra Grazzini Rucki missing children, and I have some insights on that that is not being covered by the press. Well, some issues have been picked up, but there's just a lot more to it. Been some federal warrants issued and some laptops seized and various people that's just been taking place. So we have a lot of stuff on that. Was at a signing ceremony down at Governor Dayton's office today. The family law bills that we've talked a lot about on this show that passed last legislative session. So back in May, there was the signing actually took place, but this was the ceremonial signing where they just brought the parties in that were dealing with the bill, and they went and took pictures and said hi and shook hands and stuff like that. So we got some video from that. I was the only video press people there to take it, so you're only going to see it on this show. So some of the stories that have broken on this show are getting national attention right now. But before we get into that, for some reason, and I don't get this, okay, the main part of our show, well, I get this part. The main part we're going to talk about is the Rushline corridor today, and we're going to get right into that. But for some reason, somebody's already calling in the show to make a comment or question, which I welcome, but this is going to be a surprise. So, all right, caller, you got a comment or question?
I have a comment for you.
Okay.
I just received my City of Grant newsletter, and one of the things that's printed in there is that the city has never adopted the Roberts Rules of Order. Now, Mayor Carr insists he has. Of course, he's changed them, and he calls them, you know, basically it's the Thomas Rules of Order. He puts things on the consent agenda, such as illegally putting the legal newspaper on there. And by statute, you have to have a unanimous vote to change the legal newspaper. But they changed the legal newspaper so the charter would cost $40,000. But in Jeff Huber, in his article in the newsletter, says that City has never adopted Robert's Rules of Order. I just thought if you might comment on that, Robert's Rules, and explain that and how you can put things on the consent agenda. Just give a real brief thing before you go on with the rest of your show. And I enjoy your show very much. You bring some very salient points to the public, so they're aware of what's going on. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That's Lauren Cedarstrom. Council member from the City of Grant, and a lot of chaos over there because of, unfortunately, they got city council members and a mayor that don't understand rules of procedure. And so if the mayor, Thomas Carr, is saying, hey, we follow Robert's Rules of Order, then he doesn't follow Robert's Rules of Order. And I've looked at the City of Grant, their paperwork. There is nothing there about Robert's Rules of Order. Therefore, it goes to the state guidelines, which imply a Robert's Rules of Order. And so basically what's happening is Tom Carr is doing whatever he wants to do. So on the consent agenda for Robert's Rules of Order, if a consent agenda means everybody agrees, we don't need a discussion, let's go on. Let's just move, we're all in agreement, you know, see you later. But what's happening is council members like Lauren Cedarstrom and Larry Renew are saying, no, I want to talk about this issue. And so therefore, by the rules, it automatically comes off the consent agenda, goes into another part of the agenda, or they can do it right then if they want. But the mayor is saying, no, you need to second it. Well, it's not required. Well, so they second it, and then they do a discussion on whether they should do it and have a discussion, and one of the council member calls the question, so there's no discussion, and they vote down the removing the items off the consent agenda. It's just, I mean, it's just bizarre over there in Grant. So now City Council Member Huber is saying there's no Robert's Rules of Order in the City of Grant. Well, there is, even though they haven't established them. So that's unbelievable what's going on there. If I was living in Grant, I'd be concerned. I'd get the Mayor Carr, City Council Member Huber, and Tina Loebum off that City Council because they're just causing chaos and spending a lot of money for that city that just doesn't need to be spent. All right, thanks for the call there, Council Member Cedarstrom. I appreciate it. So we're going to get into the Rushline Corridor, and there was a meeting in Maplewood about the Rushline Corridor where the mayor of Maplewood came in to speak and some other people came and spoke. And I went to that, and there I met Brian Weber, who's a citizen. And so, Brian, I want to thank you for coming on the show.
Sure.
You spoke out in opposition of this, and you have a multitude of reasons, but why did you even show up to the event? I mean,
well, it impacts a lot of us that live in that area, and so I wanted to find out more information about what their plans were. They started off with a number of different route options, and so they had said that they had narrowed it to three. So I wanted to find out what those three options were, more information on how they narrowed that down and what it might mean for anybody living in mm-hmm. Maplewood nearby.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, was it a helpful meeting? Did you, what did you think about the meeting overall in general?
Yeah, I think it was helpful. I met you there and some others, met some neighbors and other people that feel very similar to how I do. The information, was good to hear and get some background on what they're thinking. It wasn't necessarily great to hear what they were saying. And I had a little bit of background from they set up some tents in nearby a week or two prior, so I had a little bit of background prior to that meeting.
All right. Well, I think what I want to discuss right now is just some of the routes that they had chosen.
Sure.
And they're thinking about. So we do have a graphic on that, so if you can bring that up here. Get the computer and then show that full screen. That'd be super so people can see it there. Yeah, there we go. So this is a couple of the routes. So can you describe them, or you want to describe them here?
Yeah, sure. So what they have there starting on the bottom is where these route options would leave from downtown St. Paul mm-hmm. and travel up to White Bear Lake. They have a few different options, most of which run from Phelan along the Bruce Vento Trail all the way up to the Maplewood Mall and to White Bear Lake. And they have one option that runs along White Bear Avenue. So these are the ones that they have down selected to, most of them which all run on the Bruce Vento Trail.
Okay. Yeah, two on the Bruce Vento Trail, one goes Forest Lake, right? And the other one to White Bear Lake. I mean, they would just extend the same trail out further.
Right, so the intent would that it would go beyond White Bear out to Forest Lake. From White Bear on, it would just be train, I believe.
Okay. They haven't totally decided yet. But.
Yeah, they haven't totally decided. The route options that they have shown there are from the downtown area out to white beer.
Right.
So they have three options there. There's really only one route, I think, that they have listed after that to
okay.
Forest Lake.
All right. Well, what are some of your concerns about this light rail?
Well, there's a number of concerns that I have. The first that would come to mind would just be noise. There are other issues like vibration and, for some people, visual. To have this train go through their backyards instead of having, you know, the nice Bruce Vental trail and all that. And so during the meeting, I mean, that was one of the questions that I asked was around noise and if they had any details they could share on what they thought if this goes as a train route through the Bruce Vento Trail, how would that affect people there as far as noise? I know that they said that if that was the option, there'd be a train running through every 10 minutes. They didn't have any real good answers when it came to how loud it was going to be.
Yeah, that's I remember you asking that question,
yeah.
And that's when I go, okay, I got to talk to this guy.
Yeah.
Because they did not give you a good answer. I mean,
no.
It was like, oh, it's going to be okay, you know.
Yeah, yeah. They said that they would be looking into that in a subsequent phase where, you know, environmental, they're examining the environmental impacts, which would include vibration as well.
Okay.
But, yeah, they didn't have any real answers to that, and so
okay.
That's... seems to be a pretty big concern if they're planning on sending this through a long residential area.
Well, and I think there has to be a little remembering of history with the light rail lines that are currently in existence. If you take in downtown Minneapolis, I take the light rail, I take the buses, I do a lot of traveling that way. So downtown Minneapolis, the buildings along that light rail line, extra insulation.
Mm-hmm.
Reconstruction going on all those buildings
mm-hmm.
because of the noise factor. You got living apartments and your feet away from that
right.
light rail line coming in.
Right.
And that light rail line comes in, and if there's somebody near that track,
yeah.
they're on that horn. They're on the horn, and the bells are ringing.
Yes.
You know.
Yeah, so both would be concerned. So they talked about... we don't know exactly yet where the stations would be to get on and off.
Okay.
So I don't know how much noise or disruption those might cause.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, the train itself, if they have to blow horns, but also when it comes to crossing a street. So I live fairly close to a street they would have to cross. And so if they bring down arms and lights, if they also have to have bells on that sound, so it's not only horns but bells on the road, that would be pretty disruptive.
Well, and that, because the blue line that goes out to the Mall of America,
mm-hmm.
they do have the crossing guards that go down,
mm-hmm.
but not on the green line in St. Paul. They may have them at some places,
sure.
But because there's so much traffic crossing,
right.
I don't recall seeing them.
Right.
I was just on it today. No, they don't have it.
Right.
At least the St. Paul,
right.
down in the St. Paul area.
Right.
But the bells are ringing, and if somebody's close, they're honking that horn.
Yeah, so when I asked that question at the community meeting, they didn't really have answers on what, if they put a train line in, you know, how loud it would be, what they would have to do, if they have to have bells there.
Right.
How loud it would be. All they could really offer is that they would try to have some sort of, you know, noise cancellation. If they have bells, they would put something in around it to help direct it away from houses or not have it impact. But I don't know what they'd be willing to do when it comes to helping you or paying for any insulation or
right.
things on your house.
Yeah, that was really left unanswered.
Yeah.
Vibration, I don't know if you remember that conversation that MPR, Minnesota Public Radio, had big lawsuits in St. Paul. They sued saying, you're going to wreck our studio, you're going to be too noisy for our studios, and they sued over the vibration and that issue.
Mm-hmm.
And guess what? The Metro Transit did not care. The Met Council did not
sure.
care. They fought it. Okay, so I don't think they're going to care about the vibration.
Yeah.
I mean, that's their history.
Right.
So I think that's a pretty valid concern
right.
that you have
right.
going on there.
So
any other concerns?
Yeah, so there are, I'd say, three more concerns. Well, there's more than that, but I'd say three major ones. One would be property value.
Okay.
So they often talk about how, you know, these light rail lines and things like that increase property value. And that might be true for somebody that lives, you know, a certain distance away that is unaffected by the noise and by the vibration and everything else that is involved with that. But if you're within some proximity or directly on the line, it's quite different. I have talked to my realtor about that, and it's tough to predict exactly how much the value of your house will go down. It's just, you know that it will. Mm-hmm. So that's pretty much a guarantee that if you live right on the line or too close, that your property value is going to go down.
Somebody there testified to that event that the real yeah. estate agent had already said you got a 10 to 15% decrease
right.
in property value.
Yep.
So
yes.
a big concern. Now what I think, you know, as far as property value goes, I look at that blue line
mm-hmm.
going out Highway 55, and there was a lot of places to be developed. And of course they you know, they built a lot of high density housing along the line.
Mm-hmm.
In my mind, not close enough to make it worth it, even though it's close.
Mm-hmm.
You're still going to have to be doing some significant walking
right.
in some of those places. Has it improved the area? Yes, mm-hmm. but that's a different area. There was not a whole lot of development along there.
Right.
Where here, where we're talking going through Maplewood and St. Paul,
mm-hmm.
it's all developed.
Yes.
Very, very heavily developed.
Yes. A lot of residential neighborhoods that it's going to be going through.
So I don't, you know.
Well, potentially going through.
Right, yeah.
If they choose the Vento Trail options over the
okay.
White Bear options.
And so specifically about the Vento Trail option, what don't you like about that? I mean, you raised some general issues, but.
Yeah, so I think there are a few issues with that as well. So one would be, it's a pretty beautiful trail to have that a lot of people run and bike and have all that on. And to put a line in, a rail line right on that, even if they try to run it alongside, it's not going to be quite the same. And I don't know what their full plans are for that line, since they haven't gotten to planning that far yet. You know, they don't have engineering or any of that kind of stuff figured out. But to lose those trails and have this run by parks and everything else that is there is a concern and kind of a shame to lose something that's that nice and that people enjoy so much. And to have kids and other people playing around it is a concern also for safety when it's going by parks and along a trail. So I have a son myself, and that would be a concern of mine is, you know, before it'd be great. Okay, yeah, go with some friends later on, you know,
right.
bike to a park. Now
right.
it's like, you know, all right, well.
Yeah, watch out.
Avoid the trail,
right,
you know,
right.
take the street.
Watch out for the train that comes by every 10 minutes.
Right, right.
You know, and it might not be a train. So,
yeah.
You know, I think that's something that's disturbing me a little bit is that they're leaving so many options out there. In a sense, trying to force people into one option, but they're leaving all these other options out there, but they're forcing you in a direction. They're going for the Bruce Vento Trail. I mean, that's what I get
yes,
out of it.
Yes, it seemed, from that meeting, it seems like they have their heart on the trail options and light rail and those kind of things. There was a lot of talk on the benefits that, you know, of light rail for businesses and things like that. And so I guess part of the problem is that they're not having it run by businesses over that period. They're having it run on a trail through residential neighborhoods. And doing so mainly because it's easy and convenient for them, since they have some of that land, and it'd be easy to put it in along there. But it's, as far as the utility of it, mm-hmm. People that live nearby do not want that going in for all the noise and other concerns that I just mentioned. And all of the businesses, so the real benefit, they say, is to the businesses and things like that. Well, if they sent it up, White Bear, if they send something up there, there's a lot of businesses that can then benefit. Mm-hmm. Same, one of the previous options that they had, so one was to send something up White Bear. There was one that was along 61 and Arcade Street, which has now been removed. So there are businesses there that could potentially benefit as well. So I guess I would say, if there are businesses and business owners that want this to go by their place, especially on White Bear, which they're still considering, I'd say now's the great time to speak out about it.
Well, you need to speak out now.
Yeah, yeah.
Because they have eliminated Highway 61.
Yes.
And in my mind, from all the bus riding I do, mm-hmm. that's the best route, mm-hmm. Because businesses are there versus versus homes.
Yes.
It just baffles me.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I don't know what they're thinking with that. There's something else going on.
Yeah.
And I can see them. The airport to downtown Minneapolis, Minneapolis to St. Paul, even though it's not sustainable, it's not financially sustainable, they're not going to make any money, it's not going to break even, it's a huge cost. I don't know what they're connecting here, up here.
Right.
There is no stadium, there is no airport.
Right.
There's nothing. So what's going to be the draw to have people use this light rail line?
Right.
I don't know what it is. I mean, do you have any ideas there?
No, not really. The only options that I would consider if people want to go down, say they want to catch a Saints game or something, there's random events that people, but as far as, using it a lot, I don't have a need. I don't know many people that do.
Well, but right now, let's say it's the Saints game.
Yeah.
You come up here to Maplewood Mall, you get on that 64, you can be down at the Saints ballpark in 40 minutes to 50 minutes.
Yeah.
And then same on the way back.
Right.
Get you back to the Maplewood Mall.
Yes.
If the express bus was running, but they don't.
Right.
At that time. Except coming out of St. Paul, but they wouldn't be running at the end of the game.
Right.
It may take you 30 minutes.
Right.
And you don't have to take your car. You don't have to pay for parking. It's actually, if you're used to the bus system and know how it works, it's actually pretty good, except for the time that it takes.
Right.
Sometimes it takes from Maplewood 2 hours just to get to not necessarily to downtown Minneapolis. But to get, 3 miles south of downtown Minneapolis, mm-hmm. it's maybe an hour and a half to 2 hours.
Yeah.
And you go, and then you got to come back. So that's 3 hours spent to get someplace that isn't that far away.
Right.
So it's just, you got to have them, I think, the buses and stuff. But the practicality for time efficiency isn't there.
Yes.
So.
Yeah.
So you would like to see it on 61?
Well, 61 would be a good option. I wouldn't be opposed to White Bear for the reasons I just mentioned as far as businesses and other things. So, if we talk about getting downtown to see some of those things, well, there are other options that could provide the same service that don't disrupt mm-hmm. residential neighborhoods and could possibly benefit even more businesses.
Mm-hmm.
So...
And there are already parking venues along 61.
Right, which is another thing, is how do you get to these stations?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, which you know, the Met Council, Metropolitan Council, makes decisions about transportation. So what was interesting is they just spent millions of dollars on the park and ride at Maplewood Mall, and, you know, just got done within the last 2 years, and now they're talking about just totally skipping right by it.
Yeah.
You know, you go park and ride at the Maplewood Mall, and you still have to walk about four blocks to catch the light rail.
Right.
If they have a station there on Beam Avenue.
Right. Yep.
So, I don't see how this is going to work. Do you think it's too late for 61, or do you think people could?
I don't know that it's necessarily too late. So what their plan is that they had proposed was to review these final few options that we showed at the start of the show, and then to make a recommendation springtime next year, and then I think gather a little bit more information and make you know, more of a final recommendation on it during the summer. And then after that, they would, city council and others would vote on this, whether or not to pass this, in which case it'd move into the other phases, which would be environmental and engineering, and then it'd have to go into trying to get funding.
Okay.
And so I don't think it's over as far as, you know, these three options. If there is a lot of strong public opinion that nobody likes these options, and that there are better options, and so I think that that would still have a lot of influence, and so that's why they have rushline.org to put in your feedback. I mean, you could even contact city council members or the mayor or whoever to be heard, but they have a website where you can enter in your thoughts on this. So if there are people out there that, you know, don't want this going in on the Vento Trail, and or businesses, like I said, that would prefer other routes, you know, I would just recommend going on there and filling all that in, because they're still in the process of figuring out, you know, what is the best route.
Right. So the map we showed here, that was on rushline.org. So it's very well put together website. Except for probably some of the downfalls, some of the pitfalls. Now, at the meeting that was in Maplewood, you know, I asked the question: how many people here actually take the bus?
Yeah.
On a regular basis, and I would say there was about 80 people there, 90.
Yeah.
Anyway, somewhere between 60 and 90 people there. Three people actually took the bus, including the people designing the light rail, and then how many were property owners, and the rest were property owners that this line is going to affect,
right?
Which you would expect. I would think part of the comeback from Met Council, Metropolitan Council, who wants to develop this, is this is just a case of not in my backyard. You know, I don't want it. Mm-hmm. You know, so let's discount that. you know, have you heard any of that kind of talk, and what would be your answer to that?
So among the people in charge of this, just sort of
this is just disgruntled people, not in my backyard, I don't want to have this happen,
you know,
put it in somebody else's backyard.
Right. Well, whenever you ask about why would you want this or why do you want a light rail, they basically always say the same answers, that it helps out businesses and helps build up those kind of things around the line. And so my answer or my response to that would be, well, what's the point of sending this along the Vento Trail then, where you have all these residential houses and you can't build up any businesses, you can't help out any businesses, there's nothing to put in and build, you have all these houses that are already there. So if there are other options to you know, help out any of those businesses, you know, their other routes seem to help or be better off for that.
Well, and the only property that's available for development and I don't want to use the word available, that there's nothing there would be parks.
Yeah.
So the whole, you know, in Maplewood, there's a number of parks along that that line. Houses on one side, a park on the other side of the line.
Yes.
So they would, in order to put a business in or put apartment buildings, high density housing, because that's, they think if we put in high density, then people will use the line.
Yeah.
It'll take away from the parks.
Yeah.
Which is a strength of Maplewood.
Yes.
You know, they have a good park system. They have a lot of nice parks.
Yeah, one of the draw for me in purchasing my house was those trails and those parks. Also, when they talk about building things up, I guess there's a question of whether or not they really need it. Is there a need for people traveling downtown? I'm not sure the answer is yes, or if there'd be people that use this, you know, how many people would use this for commuting? It's more of that they think that this, you know, hope that this would benefit all those businesses and help build up those things versus, the other needs.
Yeah, you know, as far as commuting goes, it's amazing how many, what is happening now in commuting. And you go to the Maplewood Mall Transit Center and the 270 starts there going to downtown Minneapolis. So depending on traffic, whether it's good or bad, you're going to get downtown pretty much faster than taking your car.
Yes.
Okay, but it's from a point to point. Once you get downtown, then, you know, you still got to work through things there. But I think that's a good thing. But the problem with it is it's one way. It just goes down there. Mm-hmm. So that's what commuters do. They go down, and then in the afternoon they come back, it's called the Express.
Yeah.
And it's nice. And those buses are pretty much full.
Right.
But there's about, I'm going to just educate a guess here. I can look it up. But there's 20 buses in the morning going down to Minneapolis.
Yeah.
There's about 7 to 10 going down to St. Paul.
Yes.
On the Express. Mm-hmm. Which means, you know, not that many people are going to downtown St. Paul versus Minneapolis from up here.
Right.
But those that are going, the buses are doing the job.
Yes. And so there's a whole lot of other route options that would be fine for commuter traffic. Mm-hmm. And their choice for putting it in here wasn't commuter traffic. It was all these other reasons.
Okay.
Like trying to get it build up Maplewood with, you know, infrastructure and businesses and all these other things. That is the reason for choosing this path along the Vento Trail versus, you know, like 35E was an option that they took off, which would, you know, there's a lot of things that could help with commuter traffic.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of contradicting because their whole reason to put it on the Bruce Vento Trail and through there would be to generate this new business. And they're sending it through a section that they can't do that, right?
Right.
So,
I don't get it. Any other concerns that you have there?
No, I don't know that I have any other concerns. I think we covered most of it. I know that there's an election.
Yes,
coming up.
That's right. And speaking of that, do you know where anybody is standing on that issue?
So our current mayor, Mayor Nora Slawick, she was at this meeting, and it was very clear what her stance was on being pro for the Vento Trail options. And so, she even got up and talked about that at that meeting. And so it's very clear where her stance is. As far as some of the other candidates, I don't know all the details on that. I know that there was a meeting this last Thursday. Unfortunately, I was not able to attend. But yeah, that's another thing that I would encourage people is to go online and look up what the different candidates' stances are. I know there is a number of them that said that they are against putting that line in on the Bruce Vento Trail. And so if you, again, would prefer it to be a different option, you know, you can choose a candidate that hopefully will help fight alongside of us.
Right. I think that was interesting, and I brought this up to, well, we got a phone call here, so we got to remember about Mayor Slawik and what she's doing wrong in this process.
Sure.
But caller, do you have a comment or question? Thanks for calling in.
Yeah, I'm sure glad you brought up Nora Slawik. Could you answer me the question, how does she think you're going to get commercial activity on the Bruce Vento Trail when it backs up to houses on both sides of the trail? Now, there's no commercial involvement in any way, shape, or form connected with that trail. So Nora Slawik doesn't know what she's talking about. That's for dang sure, and we know that when we see her trying to operate the council meetings, when she has to have somebody tell her what the next step is. So thank you, and don't pay any attention to that nitwit. Thank you.
All right. Well, thanks for feeling free to share your opinion there. I appreciate that. How do you really feel about that? Here's a big problem, that the mistake that she's making, and I brought this up with Councilmember Cardinal. I says, your job here is to do a motion in city council that you get this on the table, because Nora Slawik is supposed to be representing Maplewood.
Mm-hmm.
And when she comes to that commission on this light rail, mm-hmm. she has one responsibility, and that's to say what the Maplewood City Council, as representatives of the people of Maplewood, have decided on this issue.
Right.
And Councilmember Cardinal has not done that yet.
Yeah.
And is running out of time. And I think the reason he's not doing it is because elections are coming up and he doesn't want to show his hand as to where he really is on that. So, I mean, that's the first thing I think has to happen for Slawik, is to quit pushing the line, find out where the people of Maplewood feel about this, have a meeting, an open meeting, where the citizens come in and discuss it. That hasn't happened yet.
Right.
It's just, that is just terrible governance, which means it's about her, what she wants, who knows how she's getting funding. You know, obviously, Met Council is pushing money around. Some developers are pushing money around. The light rail companies are pushing money around.
Yeah.
But the Maplewood citizen, who cares? You know, that's how that's how I see that.
Yeah. And so there's I guess when it comes to people's opinion, there's a difference between, you know, somebody saying, would you like it there? And be like, sure. You know, why not? And they'll use it like, what, once a year, and doesn't affect them. So there's a lot of difference between, you know, that kind of response versus the people that it really impacts.
Yeah.
And so, you know, as far as how positive people are, the people that are for it, you know, might be kind of tough to say. You know, if they're really, truly going to use this a lot, in commutes or other purposes, versus people that'd be like, oh, sure, that'd be nice or convenient to have maybe once a year for a random trip downtown.
That's, you know, that's it right there. That'd be nice. You know, it's a toy.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, without considering the cost that it does to the taxpayer for very little benefit.
There's,
it'd be just so easy to select a route, put a bunch of buses on it. Do that first. See if you get the ridership.
Right.
See what the cost effect of that would be.
Right.
Have your consistent times. Even the light rail isn't consistent.
Right.
But because it's more frequent, it seems like it's more consistent. You know?
Right.
So do it a cheaper, better way. Figure out your routes that way.
Yeah.
You still don't want buses, and that's another thing they said. We'll put buses on the rush line. What do you think about buses as a option on the Vento Trail?
Well, it might you know, I don't know about the noise difference. It might be better there as far as property value. You know, the noise might be a critical factor for property value. And, you know, so it still has the issue that it's not helping businesses and it's still going through residential neighborhoods, even if it is a bus. It might be better than some of the light rail options for noise or other things like that and less disruption to the people that live there. But as far as the business thing, it's, you know, as far as things going down White Bear, that could actually help them, you know?
Yeah. Well, and if they do a bus, they really don't need to do the trail because their street's right along the trail. The only reason for the trail would be that they think they can go faster.
I think the reason they choose that is for convenience.
Okay.
Because I think that's something that they own and have allowed parks to put that in there. And for a while, they didn't even put up signs letting people know that, you know, it wasn't, that there was an option that they might put a train in.
Yeah.
You know, so there's a lot of people that live there or built there or that had no idea that something like this could even go in when they purchased their house.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm in that boat along with most other people.
Yeah.
So.
Well, another thing that the other thing that I've heard is that whether it's light rail or bus going up the Ventura Trail, the trail will still be there. They will still keep it. And, I mean, what do you think of that? They'll still have the trail where people can bike up and down.
Yeah.
Do you see that as a possibility of even happening, you know?
Well, maybe. They might
being
do it.
Being able to work at all.
I don't know. So, you know, when people go out and exercise, sometimes, so people say they exercise, they run, they bike, they do all those things. Part of what's nice about it is putting the rest the world behind you, going out somewhere relaxing, nice, fresh air, good scenery.
Yeah.
Now all of a sudden you take, you know, nice landscaping and parks and things like that, and you have loud trains and
buses and
whatever else that they might put in there. Or even people that go out to walk their dogs or, you know, like I mentioned safety, you know.
Yeah, I can tell you, you know, I've never been on that trail. I was on it about a month to 6 weeks ago. Rode my bike down it, and I just go, your issue of tranquil.
Yeah.
That is
yeah.
huge.
Right.
I see people riding bikes in the Hiawatha Corridor, the Blue Line, and I'm going, compare that to the Vento Trail.
Sure.
I mean, that is tranquil. Right. People in this weather, in the fall, and the take that trail, it is beautiful.
Right.
It is a treasure, to say the least.
Yes.
And that would go away. You wouldn't have that tranquility.
Right.
You still have a bike trail, but so what?
Yeah.
not good. Issue on the candidates.
Yeah.
Two of the candidates are endorsed by the DFL party. And I say that in references to what takes place in the process. And so this is mostly a big spending DFL-led project, although you have rhinos, Republicans in name only, that will do the spending too. You cannot go against your party on some of these issues. The power of the party is too much.
Right.
And so the two people that got the DFL endorsement, Zhang and Smith, even though they say they don't want it, they'll vote for it. That's my opinion.
Sure.
I don't know what your position on that is or not.
Yeah, I mean, I can't really speculate on what they would or wouldn't do. You would hope that they would stick to their word, and so that's why, you know, I think it'd be good for everybody to look up things and talk to their neighbors or anybody else that went to that meeting on Thursday, or people that have past experience, people that have lived in Maplewood a long time.
Yeah.
You know, talk to them.
Right. Well, and then that's where I want to get in with Diana Longry, is that she says 61. I know her. We've had discussions on that. She's the only candidate that wants to preserve the parks and don't see them as a development issue and raising money in a taxpayer base, which they essentially give away anyway through TIF financing. She says 61 is the route to go. Mm-hmm. But I trust her.
So do I, and so do my neighbors and other people that I've talked to. They believe that she would do that.
Yeah. And the other candidate left is Bob Cardinal, and I just think Bob's going to do what's best for him. I think he's going to see where the money is, and he's a I don't trust him with that either.
Yeah.
And he's the one I asked, will you do this? And he wouldn't give an answer.
Sure.
Will you go and make sure that the Maplewood has the citizens gets heard and Maplewood makes a vote on this issue?
Sure.
And it's not there yet.
Right.
You know. So right. We have a phone caller on the line. Caller, do you have a comment or question?
Yes, I would like to clarify a couple of people, and that's Tujong and Smith.
Okay.
Tujong claimed to be an attorney with the first letter that he sent out to the public, and it kind of you find out from the state or any other place that he is not registered as an attorney, so that was a falsehood there.
Okay.
Now, the other thing is they both say they live in Maplewood, but they don't apparently own homes in Maplewood or pay taxes in Maplewood. And you go to the state election board, and neither one of them have ever voted in any election in Maplewood.
Really?
So that's another thing that people should be concerned about. Thank you.
Are you saying they're carpetbaggers?
I don't know what kind of bag they carry, but it might be carpet.
All right.
So, thank
you. They live here now. Obviously, they must be renting, which is fine. But new to the area, to say the least.
Right.
And as you know, that's I think the caller brings up a good point, and it's a problem we have with our employees, our high level employees in Maplewood, is that none of them, very few of them, live here.
Right.
And they're really pushing the city council what direction to go, and they don't live here.
Yeah.
So
I do have a couple other comments.
Okay.
So one is, you know, they're putting in a line like this out to the southwest. And so the overall cost, I mean, I've looked it up online, is, you know, $1.7
billion. Right.
So not cheap.
For the southwest line?
Yeah. Okay. So, I mean, whatever they're going to put in here may not be cheap if it's a rail line and there's a lot of things they'd have to put in.
If it's 10 miles of rail line, it's going to be $1 billion.
Yeah, so the other thing is that when they go for federal funding, that comes with strings. So if they put it in, you know, that the federal government will fund you this money, assuming that this is going to be an operation for a certain length of time.
Uh-huh.
So if you, you know, accept their funding and put in this line and you find out, well, after 2 years that it's very disruptive, you don't really have the choice of taking it down. Right?
Right.
So it's a big decision.
It's huge.
It's a very big decision. And so I wanted to make sure that was also aware to people that what happens if they go ahead and get that funding and move forward with it. So again, now is the time to talk to everyone about it.
Right. Well, and they put the line in, they spend the money, they tear it up because they're convinced that light rail is the way to go, or bus or whatever, mass rapid transit. If they tear it up, then they go move it someplace else and tear up another community.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's kind of a one-time shot.
Yeah.
That they're looking at.
Yeah. And if you take down the trail and disrupt the parks and put in parking lots or whatever, you know, anything that they would do, it's not like you can just take it out and the park and trail go back to what it was.
Yeah. Anything else?
No, I think that's it.
Okay. Super. Well, Brian, I thank you very much for coming on the show. Appreciate it.
Sure.
And best wishes in trying to fight this thing.
Sure.
And, you know, people, you need to get a hold of your legislature. Well, that too, your legislators and your city council members, and let them know how you feel. We'll just keep it on this camera for the rest of the show here. We only got about 8 minutes left. We're going to show that video of Bob Cardinal at the talking about Maplewood Community Center, and I just let's watch it, and I'll make my comments because you know how I feel about the Maplewood Community Center. Okay, and I'll explain
and
it again.
This is a really good
but go ahead.
Question, and I can't wait to hear the answer. So we'll start again with Bob Cardinal. Should the community center be upgraded or sold or run by a private company? So in other words, what are we going to do with our community center?
Okay, first off, the community center is in a partnership right now with the YMCA. Basically, the YMCA White Bear is helping us out on the pool area. It's been a drain on the city for a long time. It was built with tax increment financing. There was not any maintenance plan 20 years ago when it was put up. No, I think it's we're spending a lot of money there, but it's for all the citizens, and you could think of it as a park. Just what does a park cost? And it's there for everybody. My family's a member. I don't go much, but my kids go a lot. As far as what we should do with it, I think we're moving in the right direction, trying to shore up the costs a little bit, get more activity there. It's a great resource. Many years ago, 3M did all their Six Sigma training at the Maplewood Community Center for 3 years when they had a CEO that required that. So now we're working on it. It's not something that we're avoiding, and I don't think we should sell it. So,
thank you. So,
all right. Wow. Here's a guy that went after the Republican endorsement. He's voted for every tax raise in Maplewood so far. Has made motions for them and seconded motions for every single tax raise. He did get the Republican Party endorsement over my objection, because he's not a Republican. And you hear another reason why, because he's about handing out special favors to individuals for who he chooses as winners and losers. He makes a couple comments about the Maplewood Community Center. It's for all the citizens. No, it isn't. It's for those who pay memberships. And they've been losing money every single year, an average of $500,000 a year. Fluctuates from about $250,000 to $1 million a year that it loses money. The city should not be doing a gym membership or a pool membership or running a banqueting facility. Cities don't do that. And when they do it, they fail. Maplewood Community Center is a failure. His only answer as a Republican would be sell the place. Okay, then it comes on our tax rolls. Instead of losing $500,000 a year, now we can get some tax money coming in off the property owners and the businesses that own it now. And then the people also will go to other businesses, privately held businesses, and do their workouts there. But see, Bob Cardinal, as a city council member, gets some free membership to the Maplewood Community Center. So is that really what's going on? Is that why he supports it? And second of all, he calls it a park. It's not a park. It can't be a park, and I didn't turn my phone down. So we'll have to do that now. Hopefully I won't get any more calls. We're almost done with the show anyway. It's not a park. It's an enterprise fund. It's a business. They got the money to fund the place by calling from the state taxpayers by calling it an enterprise fund. In other words, by law, it needs to break even, and it hasn't, and nobody's sued the city on it, you know. So we shouldn't sell it. Oh, and then he gives us example. 3M used it, you know, a few times. do you buy that? Do you really? Okay, you know, well, what are you doing now? All right, 3M, do they use it now? Of course, they get discounts. People from 3M get discounts to go there, but why not discounts to Lifetime Fitness or Snap 24 or a whole bunch of other fitness places out there? It's just bad, you know, bad policy, and the city should not be dealing with that. Okay, we only got a couple minutes left here. I'm just going to give you an update on the Sandra Gerzini-Ruckey case. I broke this case 3 years ago, okay? The whole thing that's being ignored is Judge Knutson's behavior, but Sandra Gerzini-Ruckey has two missing children. She was arrested in Florida. And is in jail, is going to be, she signed the extradition papers to come back to Minnesota here, which, you know, whether she should have done that, I don't know. She may have fought it, but she's in prison. She actually, when she was working, she works for an airlines, she was having to fly. When she flew, they had an extra staff member on her airline in case she got arrested. Okay, and they had extra security on the plane in case she got arrested. Okay, and then once the warrant was issued, she got fired from her job. That's kind of what was going on. Anyway, she's coming back to Minnesota. I think that's a good thing, get all that addressed, and she can set her bail, and then she'll be free to walk around, not having to worry about Judge David Knutson and his addicts. We're out of time. So much to tell. Maybe we'll get to it next week. Remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great week.